The secret of life is letting go. The secret of love is letting it show.
These are yours. And I believe you still heal, and demons still bow. I'm convinced there is power in trusting in a faithful God. So I will praise till you appear.
A very good morning to all of you, boys and girls and teachers. Welcome back to school. My name is Reverend Gaurri and I am your school chaplain. Before we begin, let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks that we are all able to return to school. We ask, Lord God, for your presence to be with us. We ask, Lord God, that for your protection to be upon us, even as we will eventually return, Lord God, to school physically. We pray that you will go with us and before us. And for now, Lord, as we look to your word, we pray that you will speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It is almost about 2 weeks since school has reopened for the new term. And I know that all of you have been following online classes and you will be coming back to school physically soon. I think in the coming week, if I'm not wrong. And I wonder what each one of you might be thinking in your mind. How would you expect the new school year to be, the new term, the new school term to be? Would it be another year whereby we need to be distantly be present with one another? Or would it be another year of trying to cope with our breathing, having to wear our masks for almost the whole day? Would it be an overwhelming year of having to cope or catch up with studies since the pandemic? How would you describe the new school year to be? But whatever your expectation is of the new school year, we cannot deny the fact that we need to continue to do school in the new normal. Students and teachers alike have to adapt and embrace the changes that is being forced upon us due to the pandemic. And this can be, in a sense, quite overwhelming for some of us. The expectation to do well in spite of all the challenges that we are facing can be daunting. These challenges may seem like those giants in our lives that look down upon us, waiting to taunt us. But then, who do we look to for help in these challenging situations? Today, we are going to look at a Bible story taken from 1 Samuel chapter 17. It is a story about how a young boy, David, faces a giant that was coming against his people. Now, some of you may be familiar with this Bible story, and some of you may not. 1 Samuel chapter 17 is a very long chapter. It has 58 verses, and I shall not be reading it to you, but I will highlight some of the verses as we go along the story. Hopefully, you will get to know what this story is about. So if you look at David is being introduced before chapter 17, and he is being introduced in three distinct ways. Firstly, David is being introduced as a shepherd boy. Then we see him being introduced as a very talented musician. And finally, David is seen as a very young warrior, but, you know, when he defeats Goliath, who is described as a giant in 1 Samuel chapter 17. And that's the story we are going to look at. We are going to look at how David actually defeated Goliath. Now, who is this Goliath? Goliath was a Philistine. Now, let us look at how he's being described in verses 4 to 7. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 4 to 7. It says, "A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. He was over 9 feet tall. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale of armor of bronze, weighing 5,000 shekels. On his leg, he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung in his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer ran ahead of him." Now, just imagine looking at a guy like that. And this guy, Goliath, he was not just standing there. He was actually shouting at the Israelite soldiers. He was challenging them. He shouts at them saying, "Why do you come out and line up for a battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and I kill him, you will be our subjects and serve us." Now, who do you think will be bold and courageous enough to stand up to such a challenge? None of the Israelite soldiers had the courage or bravery to do so. All of them were dismayed and all of them were terrified. All of them except David. Now, David was a very young boy. His father, Jesse, had 8 sons in total, and David was the youngest. Now, three of his oldest brothers were already in the battlefield. So they were actually there when Goliath was shouting at them. Three of his oldest brothers. David, he's the youngest. He was assigned, so in the family, you know, he was assigned the work of tending his father's flock. That's why he's being described as a shepherd boy. You know, so that's his task in the family. And besides tending his father's flock, David was also given the task whereby he is to carry food for his three brothers who are at the battlefield. So he's a shepherd boy, and then he also carries food for his brothers. And it was then when David was bringing food to his brothers that he hears what Goliath was saying, or rather shouting to the soldiers. And so David, he cannot tahan, you know, he cannot stand it. You know, so he steps forward and he volunteers himself to go fight Goliath. His own brothers did not believe him. King Saul, who was the king at that time, he was also not very convinced about David going against Goliath, because when we look at David outwardly, he does not have anything that would qualify him to fight Goliath. I mean, he's a boy, he's a young boy. And that was what Goliath would say to David, you know, when he sees David approaching him in verses 41 to 44. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 41 to 44, when David approaches Goliath, this is what Goliath would say to him. You know, he will look at David. He looked at David and he saw that he was only a boy, ruddy and handsome, and he despised him. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come at me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beast of the field." So just imagine for a moment, a very young boy standing in the presence of this gigantic bully. And if we read the story, we will notice that David had no armor on him. Why? You know, when a soldier goes for a battle, the soldier wears an armor. David doesn't have an armor. Why? Because the armor is too big and it's too heavy for him. You know, because Saul will put on David, you know, the armor. And then, you know, and when David tried to walk around with that armor, he's not able to walk around. It's too big. So if you look at verses 39 and 40, David will say, "I cannot go in these because I'm not used to it." And he's not used to wearing those huge armors. So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand. He chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with a sling in his hand, he approached the Philistine. So there you go. This boy, David, did not have with him an armor, something that soldiers will usually wear during battle. He steps into the battlefield with just 5 stones and a sling. Now, where do you think David got his courage? Where do you think is the source of David's courage and bravery? The source of David's courage and bravery was God. David had a very close relationship with God. And because he had a very close relationship with God, David was confident of God. Nowhere in the text, in this whole 1 Samuel chapter 17, nowhere in the text says that David was confident of himself. No, David's full confidence was on God. You see, when David approached King Saul and said to him that, you know, he will go and fight Goliath, Saul would say to David in verse 33, this is what Saul would say: "You are not able to go against this Philistine and fight him. You are only a boy. And he, Goliath, he had been fighting, had been a fighting man from his youth." In other words, you know, Saul was saying to David, "You know, David, you are just a kid. You have no experience of whatsoever in a battlefield. You have no idea how dangerous and how fierce the battle is. But this guy, Goliath, is someone who had been fighting since he was a youth. He has a lot of experience in fighting, but you have none." You see, but David may not have experience fighting in a battlefield, but he had experienced God's deliverance in his life. So he will say back to King Saul, say, "Your servant had been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defiled the armies of the living God. The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." Let me repeat the last sentence. "The Lord, God, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." You see, boys and girls and teachers, David's confidence was not on his own ability. It was not. In fact, if you look at him, he probably had nothing that would qualify him for such a battle. But he had God on his side. He placed his full confidence in God. It is with his own lips that he declares, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." Such was David's experience of God. David knew God through his experience while he was in the field tending his father's flock. It was more than head knowledge. What I mean is that David didn't just say, "Yeah, you know, I know God will deliver me." You know, many a times, you know, we walk around saying to ourselves, "Yeah, you know, I know God will help me." Yes, we know that God is there. We know that God will help us. But are we truly convinced that God will help us and that God is there for us? You know, David was convinced that God will deliver him and that God will grant him victory. And it was his confidence, it was with this confidence that he went to meet Goliath. With this confidence in God that he went and met with Goliath. Look at verses 45 to 47, verses 45 to 47. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. Today I'll give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel." The whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Such was David's confidence in God. Now, in these verses, it's very clear that David fought Goliath with the confidence that comes from the Lord. And as we read on, we will see that God did grant David victory. Yes, it is true, his sling and the stones that he picked up from the stream, David struck Goliath down. Look at verses 48 to 50. As the Philistine moved closer to attack David, David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and it struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell face down to the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hands, he struck down the Philistines and killed him. David won the battle. And he won the battle not because he had an amazing war strategy or that he was well equipped for battle. David was a young boy who tends his father's flock, and he won the battle. Boys and girls and teachers, it is not what we have that matters, but who we have as. It is not what we have that matters. It is who we have with us. David had no equipment that could fit him. Remember, he couldn't even wear the armor. But he had God with him, and he went to the battlefield with God. It is not what we have, but who we have with us when we face our battles. For us, for you and for me, we may not physically face a giant Goliath standing in front of us. Our battles comes to us in different forms. We might be fearful of contracting the COVID-19 virus. We may be fearful of not being able to catch up with our studies. We may be fearful because we don't know what the future holds. Do you know what the future holds? Do you know what's going to happen a month from now? Do you know what's going to happen to you like 6 months down the road? None of us know. A lot of times we can plan, but we may not know. And we may think to ourselves that we are not prepared or equipped to face the challenges that's ahead of us, or whatever that challenge might be. The challenges that you face are different from the challenges that I face. Your challenges, my challenges are different, right? But we have God who is by our side, And just like how David faced Goliath with God, we too can face our Goliath, having God by our side. So I pray that as you have already begun the new school year, whatever challenges that you might face this coming year, know that you can call upon God and He will be with you as you face your challenges. Let us pray. Father Almighty, we give you thanks for the assurance that we receive from your word today. Just like you have been with David many, 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 many years ago, Father, we believe that you are with us in our battles. Whatever we may face, Lord God, in this coming year, we know that you will be with us. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we pray. So students, boys and girls and teachers, I will continue to pray for you. And I pray that you will have a good school year. Take care.